spot on my face. Should have known. Reminded me of something once told to me by General Custer. You all remember him, don't you? One of the great dumbass men in history. Not for nothing, he graduated last in his class at West Point. Well, anyways, we saw him playing when he looks at me with this kind of far off looking sign. And here's what he said. Bill, if there is one thing a man must never fear, it's making a personal comeback. Well, naturally, I... But I just got up here.
Sorry, it's time to start.
What's the rush? Wait a second! Sorry. I seem to be trying to edge you. Well, that's all because I just come from a truly harrowing meeting. Why, it seems my manager, or rather, ancient gentleman, just made a terrible mistake and booked me into what turned out to be a ghost town. Now, I don't know what any of you folks know about show business, but let me tell each and every one of you, there ain't nothing more depressing than playing two-a-day in a goddamn ghost town.
Bill.
What?
Before we start, I'd just like to say to him that I'm fine, and anyone who thinks otherwise is wrong!
Bill, it's time.
Well, that's a book. Are you ashamed of it being looked at?
Bill.
I'm sorry. It's very hard for me to say.
A goddamn hero!
These people
come to help you, your people. I'm afraid they may be the only ones left now in Canada.
And though there were many among us who wanted to speak first, men like Red Cloud and Liverpool, and he who hears thunder and Crazy Horse, men who are great warriors, men who had counted many coups, who had been with us at the Little Big Horn when we killed Custer. I would not let them speak, for they were like me, and tended to get angry very easily. Instead, I let the young woman, Charlotte Grass, speak first. For she had not fought with us at all, but had been through the white man's school at Carlisle. Stockton. She knew something of their ways. Sitting bold like Sean Grass, speak first.
Call Shauna Grass.
Shauna Grass, come forward.
Brothers and sisters, I'm going to tell you what the Great Father told us a long time ago. He told our men to stop hunting and start farming. So they did as he said, and our people grew hungry. For the land was suited to grazing, not to farming. And even if we'd been farmers, nothing would have grown. So the Great Father said that he would send us food and clothing. But nothing came of it. And our people were sad and ill. And we asked him to send us the money that he promised us when we sold him the Black Hills. Thinking with this money, we could buy food and clothing. Nothing came of it. And our people grew sad and ill. And to save us from this sadness, the Great Father sent us Bishop Barty to teach us to be Christians. But when we told him that we did not wish to be Christians, but wished to be like our fathers, who danced with thunder and fight bravely against the Shawnee and the Crow, the Great Spirit who made the four winds and the earth, and made man from the dust of this earth. Bishop Marty, hear us! And so they said, that they thought they would like to go back to hunting. Because to live, we needed food. But we found they had been learning to farm. The buffalo had gone away, and the plains were filled now, only of their bones. Before we give you any more of our land, or leave from here, where the ones we love are going white in their coffins, we want you to tell the Great Father to send us.
I prayed for the return of the buffalo.
Fantastic! You get some torches! I'll shoot the reflections in their eyes! I'll shoot them like they were so many shining things!
I'll tell you, as much as you did what you said, I know she had a big piece.
Well, she ought to. I'll give exhibitions like this to just anybody. Especially these critters getting so goddamn hard to find. Like the old days. I got to the railroad.
Are you all right?
Sure. Yeah. I'm fine.
Spotted tail! My God, I haven't seen you in years! I've been!
What are you doing here?
Well, what are you doing here? This ain't exactly Sioux territory.
It isn't your territory either.
Well, I'm with these people. I'm scouting.
These people must be very hungry. To need so many buffalo.
Of course, these fallen buffalo also. Well, listen, I'm sure my friends will mind taking some progress. We don't stand scared of a taste of buffalo meat anyways.
Your friends, they are very strange. They seem neither men nor women.
Well, actually, they're sort of a new breed of people. Called dudes.
You like them?
Well, sure, why not? I mean, obviously they ain't kind of used to, but then again, things are changing out here. And these men are the ones who change. So if you want to be part of it, and I left behind somewhere, you just let God get used to it. You, follow what I mean? I mean, you got to adjust to the times. Make a plan for yourself. I don't know. You should have one too, for your own good, believe me.
What is your plan?
To help people. Like you, for instance, or these people I'm with. More even than that. And whatever it is I do for them.
For it?
Just so many cities. States wild these biggest and damn food! And somewhere on top of a big mountain that overlooks more plains and rivers than any other. Big old statue. Great white horse, just a wave in my hat to the people down below, thanking them for thanking me for having done whatever they're doing, if we're wrong. You got such a weird look on your face.
Hey, Cody, stay where you are.
Don't worry, I ain't watching. That's Mr. Ned Button, the well-known newspaper reporter. I think he's going to do an article on me. General Custer, who's in charge of this whole thing, pushing for an article on himself, says this may well be the most important expedition since Lewis and Clark.
By the way, where are you?
I ain't sure. Just headed to the last.
Tell me, who is this woman everyone always bows to?
Oh, the Grand Duchess. She's always in Russia. Why, she loves me. You, she ain't never seen her, really.
There are no Indians in Russia. Then I will have to study her more carefully than the other. For maybe, if she takes me back to Russia with her, I will not end like my people will end.
What?
I mean like these fools here on the ground.
Yeah, well, if you ask me, I'm being just a bit pessimistic. But you do what you want. Just remember, these folks you're studying, some people think they're
fools. Oh, no. They are not fools. No one who is a white man can be a fool.
My God, but ain't that a beautiful sight?
What shall I do?
Great picture, Cody. Front page. My God, what a matter.
What a story.
Tiger heads. Didn't mean to disturb you.
How did you know the English become such a deadly shot?
Her Excellency wonders how Buffalo Bill became such a deadly shot.
Well, you know, just in front.
practice.
I'd miss my stupid army if I had a practice.
Her Excellency says she wishes her stupid army to have some half hour rest yet. She might come back to my place and protect me. But it's no better yet. She wishes you would come back with her to her palace and protect her herself.
Oh, I'm sure the Grand Duchess is in good hands as it is. She's exaggerating. I can't believe she's not surrounded by friends.
Radical?
She's worried about something.
Very strange behavior.
I'm not even afraid of her. Perhaps if you wanted to be Buffalo Bill, I've never been afraid.
Afraid?
Outnumbered.
Well.
Go on!
Tell her!
It'll help her on plenty to write.
It will?
Absolutely. The way it's changing. People want to feel part of things. I think they're what they need. To observe. Identify with. Not really. I've been studying.
You have?
I think you'd be the inspiration of this land.
Oh, now I know you're fooling.
Not at all. Come on, tell her what she wants to know. Through my magic pencil, others are there also. Don't mention it. Thanks for meeting them like me, too.
Where can I begin? Certainly it's true
that I've outnumbered that many times.
Yes, that's it.
More times even than
I can count.
Terrific.
And I can count pretty high.
Sensation.
My degree's B12 for when you battle blows. I got my 2 6 shooters out here.
Keep it up.
13 if one of them's thin enough for a bunch of clothes. Clean through! And 14 if I got my hunting knife! 15 if there's a hard surface off which I can rip in. Shots! 20 if I got dynamite! 100 if there's rocks to start an avalanche!
What a minute.
What a minute?
Never say that.
Why, when he was, when I was riding for that. The Pony Express between Laramie and Tombstone. We just passed the Pecos, 50 drone commanders attacked. North like a barrel, whoopty deal there, barrels falling like hail smoke. Boy, they come on me so fast, they don't even have time to recognize who I am and realize that I'm actually a real good friend of theirs.
Run!
Get off the subject.
Well, there's no alternative but to fire back.
And I knocked off about 30 of that number when I realized it. Blown out of the just an arrow from me. Big bastard reached up and grabbed it. Then used it like a fly swatter. I knocked away another 19 arrows. It was headed directly for my heart. Whereupon I stood up in the stirrups, hurled the arrow about 60 yards, and killed their chief. Which depressed the remaining Indians. It sent them all scurrying home.
I guess that's what you might call typical bait.
Bravo! Bravo!
I don't feel like to kill much. For Excellency says she would like to kill as much also.
Like buffalo beef.
Like buffalo beef.
And prove that I must be intimidated!
She would prove she cannot be intimidated.
Dreadful! Dreadful! Dreadful!
I know my story may have worked just a bit too well.
That's it. This is terrific.
Shows you one, you're in Duchess's heart.
I am a villain!
Think you better find her, Comanche.
Right, well, that could be a problem.
Comanche. Comanche!
Oh, for one thing, the Comanche lived in Texas. And me and you were in Missouri.
Comanche! Comanche!
I ain't exactly sure what they look like.
Must be smiling.
My name is Spotted Tail. My father was a Sioux. My mother, part Cherokee, part Crow. No matter how you look, just not Comanche.
that one to spit? For excellency wanted to put the man she used to shot her friend.
He said, I should have stayed at home in Texas with the rest of my Comanche tribe.
Fabulous. Absolutely fabulous.
Fort Laramie, Fort Rice, and Fort Laramie.
We signed a number of treaties, parts of which have never been fulfilled.
Which parts?
At Fort Rice, the government advised us to be at peace, and said if we did so, we would receive a span of horses, 10 chickens, 5 bulls, and a wagon.
You really believe these things were in the treaty?
We were told they were.
You saw them written?
We cannot read very well, but we were told they were. We were also promised a steamboat.
Steamboat?
A steamboat! What in God's name were you supposed to do with a steamboat in the middle of the plains?
I don't know.
Cody, where is the great father? The one you said would help us. The one you said you knew so well.
Mr. President, Honorable First Lady, before you stands a character, most shady. Today, his presence darkens this bright earth more than does the moon's eclipsing girth. Forgive me, Ned Buntline is the name. It's me who brought Bill Cody fame. Wrote 27 books for him, the hero. Made a better known man, Nero. What's that? You say? I'm rude to Bill the spouse, when I'm the guest of such a clean White House? Fear not, there's something I didn't mention. Recently my soul found redemption. Though we sold them cheap, one for a dime, the two of us was rich in no time. As my soul's redemption became thus, I saw the nation profit more than us. With each one of my exciting stories, Cody grew to represent its glories. Also helped to lead his conscience. I showed him pessimism's nonsense. Later, when people asked to see him, I wrote a play for him to be in. The scene of which we now perform for you, as you so graciously implored us to. Cody, of course, impersonates himself, as does yours truly. The Crow Maiden is Italian actress Paula Monduli, the evil brawny chief, the great German actor Gunther Hookman. Our other Indians, I'm afraid, all come from Brooklyn. As a special treat tonight, a visitor is here. I've added some new dialogue, so they might appear. Remember, though, this man's come as Cody's friend. He's not an actor. On my play, who men are is the real factor. So get set then for anything. May the script be damned, and let's give Cody and Wild Bill Hickok a rousing hand. Out there. this unlikely quest?
Damn good question.
Could it be that you seek, as I do, the camp of Uncas, evil Pawnee chief?
Yes, Pharaoh. We seek his camp so that I, the great Buffalo Bill, can once again save someone in distress. This time, specifically, a virgin.
You got it, Joe.
Will you shut up? Who? Lest I sit, face this torture, sacrifice, and certain violations.
This being so, let us join forces and save this virgin together.
This ain't a proper place for a man to be.
I'm doing all I could to entertain him. We're making him happy. Show him the West. You go spend your life in Dodge City. Well, I got bigger things in mind.
To repeat, this being so, let us join forces and save this virgin together.
Come on, these guns are loaded.
Hark! The maiden's name is called.
Yes,
we must be near the camp of Uncas.
Evil Pawnee Chief.
I'm being sick.
Guns ready, ears alert. Mouth shut, eyes open, so that I, the great Buffalo Bill, can what? What are you doing? What are you doing? I'm doing what I'm doing. That's what I'm doing.
Always was intelligent.
I'm doing what my country wants, what my beloved country wants. This
is what you want.
Absolutely.
Let's put it up to you.
When a man has a talent, a God-given talent, I think it's his God-given duty to make the most of it. You see, what you fail to understand is that I'm not being false to who I was. I'm simply taking what I was and raising it to a higher level. Now, on to the show.
Avast, ahoy, above yon trees, the pale moon rising. Feel the night envelop us like a dark dream. We approach on tiptoes.
God, pray we're in time!
I'm watching a girl. No her name. How are you?
This fight attacked me.
We really should have more things like this. Oh my god.
Saved! A maiden betrayal of rapture. Yes, saved. Not a bit too soon. Already my soft thighs have been pried open, my budding dress pricked by the hot tip of an Indian spear. Yet through it all, my maiden head stayed secure. Here, in a little pouch, kept in a secret pocket, where no one thought to look, thus his innocence preserved. May it resume what God of thunder grant me happiness.
Why not have that speech?
I think she changed a little.
Okay, chief of the Pawnee Indians. Recently killed from my left away. Yet, before the white man came between me, I had a vision that the white man is great, that the red man is nothing. So if a white man killed the red man, we forgive him. But God intended man to be as great as possible. By eliminating the inferior, the great man carried on God's work. This vision has brought light into my otherwise dark soul. And now I die again.
Fall in line right there?
I said, don't you change a little
bit. Well, man, I don't know. People seem to like it. It's our style.
Yeah? Well, then I guess it's my turn then.
Oh, hey.
Hey, boy, Mother Moon, don't let you mark, friend or no.
Hell.
You, Bonnie, you famous lizard, you harmless bull, you bald!
Bring down the curtain!
a humiliation to have him impersonate my own personal self.
Oh.
Fantastic!
Well, I don't know what to say.
Well, it weren't in the deal.
Deal?
You said if I came here, I could play Batman, Sampson.
Oh, God!
Well, if you remember, I said maybe you could play Batman, Sampson. We had to see how well you did.
Hickok first! As Hickok! For Christ's sake, I am Hickok!
Right.
Well, why don't you not play him then?
Well, there's audience appeal.
There sure is.
Bill, no, let's calm this down and talk it over. Let's have a little ride. Let's not get too carried away.
You don't have this. I'm going to slam your stuff together and extract inch by inch what Hudson knows both about you is thorough garbage.
Now, Bill, if you...
Shut up, you don't do this, fraud.
What?
I gotta play Hickok. I'm gonna play Hickok the way Hickok should be played.
Please, that way. Cody, help me do it!
I'm sorry, Will. I guess I just ain't used to show business yet.
Oh, Santa Maria! I don't like this green in his eye.
Ooh, hell, sweet!
Yes!
Express. Which would you prefer, cows or lamb?
We prefer them both.
Well, what if you can't have them both?
We prefer the lamb.
Well, then, if you knew you had to come for your land to get these cows, why'd you sign the treaty?
The white man made our heads dizzy, and finally it was an accident.
Accident?
They talked in a threatening way, and when we asked questions, called us stupid. Suddenly, the Indians around me rushed up and signed the paper. I could not stop them. They were like men stumbling in the dark.
You signed it too.
Miss Grass, tell me, do the Indians really expect to keep all this land and yet do nothing towards supporting themselves?
We do not need to support ourselves. The Great Father promises everything we would ever need, and for that we gave him the Black Hills.
Miss Grass, which would you prefer, to be self-sufficient or to be given things?
For them both. Well, you can't have them both.
Please!
I only know what we were promised.
That is not what you were promised.
We believe it is!
What's going on here?
Miss Grass, wouldn't you and your people like to live like the white man? We are happy like the Indians.
But she means, wouldn't you prefer to have your people made greater, let's say?
That is not possible. The Cheyenne and the Sioux are as great as people can be. Extraordinary, really.
Miss Grass, surely your people would like to improve their condition?
We would like what you owe to us. If the white man wants to give us more, that is fine also.
Well, we will see what we can do.
Let's call the next Indian. This is getting us nowhere.
We would especially like the money the Great Father sent when he was holding it for us.
I'm afraid that may be a little bit difficult, since in the past, when an Indian's been given money, he's spent it all on liquor.
In the past, when an Indian's been given money, it's been so little, there's been little else he could buy.
Whatever! The Great Father does not wish to see his Indian children getting drunk.
Then tell the Great Father, who wishes us to live like the white men, that when an Indian gets drunk, he is merely imitating the white man he's observed.
Good for my people. For the next year, twice a day, three times on Sunday. This to those sitting in the dark who I could not see, a light shining so bright in my eyes.
Tell General Howard I know his heart.
I'm tired of fighting. Great chiefs are all dead. Looking Glass is dead. The old men are all dead. My people, some of them, fled to the hills and have no food or warm clothing. I want to have time to look for my children, to see how many I can find. Perhaps I won't be dead.
Hear me, my chiefs. I am tired. My heart is sick and sad. From where the sun now stands, I will fight no more. Forever.
After which, the army is on the plot.
The sun dance was the one religious ceremony come to all time. The Sioux, the Crow, the Arapaho, the Pawnee, and the Cheyenne. Well, it was their way of doing things. Really, the bravest of them would take the end of long leather tongs and stick them through their chest muscles, and then pull till they bit them out. The greater the pain, the more the greater they felt the spirits would favor them and grant them salvation. And give them what they need. All since the government has officially outlawed this ritual, we will merely imitate, and no one will be hurt.
Yeah.
Come on, get it. Come on, get it. Yeehaw! Come on, Billy! Come on, Billy! Yeehaw! Cody, my old buddy, welcome back. Long time no see.
Yes, sir. Long time no see.
Consider the figures, Bronco Riding. Giddy up, yarner, son of a gun!
Sir, what I've come to talk about is very...
Come on! Can't hear you. Speak up.
Yeehaw! Sir, would you stop this?
Come. What?
Stop this!
Whoa, Nelly.
All right, what is it? I'm here to ask if you can come with me to Sitting Bull's reservation.
Whose reservation?
Sitting Bull's. He was in my Wild West show for a time, and naturally I feel sort of... obligation, a personal obligation.
I see.
I figure you're about the only one left now who can really help. His people are in a very desperate way.
Tell me, this Sitting Bull, isn't he the one who wiped out Custer?
Well, yes he was, but it was nothing personal.
Can't help.
What?
I'm sorry, but I can't help.
Look, you don't understand.
I don't? All right, let's say I want to help him. What do I do for him? Do I give him back the land? Do I resurrect the buffalo?
You can't do other things!
No, Cody. Other people can do other things. I must do magic. Well, I can't do magic for him. It's too late.
I promise they will be come.
And you're a fool.
They're going to die.
Tell you what. Since I'm so grateful to you for your Wild West show, but what it's done for this country, it's pride, it's glory. I'll do you a favor. I'll send a committee in my place.
A committee won't be able to help!
Oh, I think the gesture will mean something.
To whom?
Being a great president, Cody, is like being a great eagle. A great hunted eagle. I mean, you've got to know when to stay put. On your way out, Bill, tell the gardener we're visitors. Come on, Nelly! Come on, Nelly! Yeehaw! Come on, Nelly. Faster, Bill.
They're not stupid. They just don't see things the way you do.
Yes.
Because they are stupid. They're not stupid.
Then they must be blind. It is the only other explanation.
All right, tell me. Do you understand something of their ways?
Why should I want to understand people who are stupid?
Because if you don't, your people will starve to death.
Land itself.
You see, the majority of them don't understand how land can be owned. In figure we're kind of stupid to pay good money for it. As much as someone would be stupid to pay good money for the sky, say, or the ocean. What I'm getting at is this. If their way of seeing things is hard for us to figure, ours is just as hard to get. It's an old Indian legend. It says when the first white man came, he asked the Indian for just enough room to lay his blanket on him for the night. So he said yes. And by morning, he didn't wrap his blanket until it was one long piece of thread and roped off a couple square miles. The Indian finds that behavior hard to understand. I don't know. You think about it, it's not good myself.
We shall think about it. And hope that the Indians think about it too, and cause no more disturbances like the one just now.
Ask City Bull if he has anything else to say.
City Bull? Of course, I'll speak if they desire it to. I suppose it is any such men as they desire who may say anything.
Anyone here may speak. If you have something to say, we will listen. Otherwise, remain silent.
You know who I am and you talk.
City Bull, please!
I wish to say that I fear I spoke hastily just now, calling you stupid. My friend William Cody says you are here with good intentions. Therefore, I ask forgiveness for my unthinking words, which may have caused you to wreak vengeance upon my people, for not what was their doing, but mine alone.
We are pleased to hear you speak so sensibly. You are forgiven.
I shall tell you then what I want you to say to the great father for me, and I shall tell you everything that is in my heart. The great spirits are looking down on me today, and they wish me to tell you everything that is in my heart. For you are the only people now who can help us. Beasts. That is all I have to say.
him, and I want all the Indians to listen to what I have to tell them. Sitting Bull, this committee invited you here for a friendly talk. When you spoke, however, you insulted us. I understand this is not the first time you've been guilty of such an offense.
Tell me, do you know who I am that you talk as you do?
I know you are Sitting Bull.
You do not recognize me, then?
I said I know you are Sitting Bull.
You know I am Sitting Bull. But do you not recognize what position I hold?
We do not recognize any difference between you and the other Indians.
Then I shall tell you the difference. So you will never, ever forget again. I am here by the will of the Great Spirits. By their will, I am the chief. My heart is red and sweet with blood, and I know it is sweet. But whatever I pass near tries to touch me with its tongue, as a bear tastes honey and leaves lick the sky. Tell the Great Father for me that if the Great Spirits have chosen anyone to be leader of their country, it is not him, it is myself.
Who is this creature?
I will show you.
Just a minute, Sitting Bull. Let's get something straight. You said to this committee that you were the great chief that peopled this country, and that you were appointed chief by the Great Spirits. Well, I want to say you are not appointed chief. Appointments are not made that way. And furthermore, I want to say that you are arrogant and stupidly proud. We are not the great chief that peopled this country. Or any other, that you have no power, no control, no following, and no right to be controlled.
I wish to say a word about my not being a chief, having no authority and being proud.
You are on an Indian reservation merely at the suffering of the government. You're fed by the government, you're clothed by the government, your children are educated by the government, and everything that you have and are today is because of the government. I say these things merely to inform you that you cannot insult the people of the United States of America or its committees. And I would like to say to the rest of you that you must learn that you are equals of other men. You must not let this one man lead you astray. You must stand up to him, and you must not let him insult the people who have come all this way just to help you. That's all I have to say.
I wish to say a word about my not being a chief, having no authority, being proud, and considering myself a great man and general.
We do not care to hear any more from you today.
I wish to say a word about my not being a chief.
We do not care to hear any more from you today.
A man is the chief of a great people, and has lived only for those people, and has done all he can for them. Of course, he should be proud.
Come on, time.
Where is Hickok?
Thank you, Frank.
First, you made it for Well, I'm surprised. Not exactly what you have in mind, but I'm sure once you think about it, you'll agree. It's the only way. Just like what Billy has. Doc Holliday. The boys.
What are you talking about?
Why, taking what you were and raising it to a higher level. Naturally, for my services, I get a small fee. Percentage. You get 50% right out of the top. Of course, if at any time you're unhappy, why, you can just leave. Take your business elsewhere. That's written in. Keeps us on our toes. Mind you, this enterprise is still in its infancy. The potential, though, is unlimited. Why, think of this. The great national good that can come from this. Some of you, let's say, would concentrate purely on theatrics. Meanwhile, others of you would concentrate purely on humanitarian affairs. Say, well, not Sitting Bull, but some Indian down in Florida. Another one up in Michigan. Perhaps expanding into Canada. Mexico. Central America. South America. My God, there must be literally millions of people who can benefit by your presence. Your simultaneous presence.
Forgive me, senora.
Naturally, we still got a few wrinkles to iron out. But with you here, exercising artistic control, why, we could go on like this forever.
And now to close! And now to close!
Not yet. They also killed the rest of this tribe.
That I understand perfectly. But I cannot understand. down, however, is why you did all this. And at the same time, professed your love.
Well, what about your mistakes, hmm? For example, you were very unrealistic about things. For example, did you really think the buffalo would return? Magically return?
Seemed no less likely than Christ is returning. And a great deal more useful. When I think of their reception here, I wonder why you would want to come back.
For a while, I actually thought my wild west was dead. I could give you food and clothing. Also help people understand things better. But it's not a reason. At least part of the reason.
The show was very popular.
We had fun though together, you and I, didn't we?
Yes. And that's the terrible thing. You know, Sullivan, you no longer fight or hunt. You could do nothing. And then you came, your Wild West show. For a time, we could imagine our past glory. It was humiliating. Or sometimes we could almost imagine it was real. Yes, it wasn't so authentic, was it? How could it have been? Killed all your performers in one afternoon.
You know what worried me most? I was dying. Right in the middle of my arena. With makeup on. That's what worried me most.
What worried me most? Something I'd said a year before. Stop thinking.
What?
We'd all surrendered. We were in front of the reservation, the soldiers leading us into the fort. As we walked, I knelt to my son, who was beside me. Now, I said, now you'll never know what it is like to be an Indian. For you'll never again have a gun or phone. Only later did I realize what I'd said. These things, the gun and the pony, they come from you. And then I thought to myself, how horrible it would be to owe to the white man not only our destruction, but our glory as well. You were my friend. Indeed, you still are. I never killed you. But I knew you would not now.
If only I could have saved your life!
Cherokee Indians
and anxious furthermore to end the seemingly inevitable hostilities between its residents and its Indians. On the question of land ownership, initiated last year, forced removal of the Cherokee Nation, resettling them in a lovely and relatively unsettled area west of the Mississippi. Known as the Mojave Desert. Given proper irrigation, this spacious place should soon be blooming. Reports that the Cherokees were unhappy at their removal are decidedly untrue, and no man naturally died while marching from Georgia to the Mojave Desert to ones who did, I'm told, were rather ill already, nothing short of medication could save them. Indeed, in all way, our vast country is speedily being opened for sale. Shipment of smallpox and best of blankets sent by the Red Cross to the Mandan Indians has, I'm pleased to say, worked wonders, and the Mandans are no more. Also, the government policy of exterminating the buffalo, a policy which I myself was intimately connected, has practically reached fruition. There are almost no buffalo left now, and soon the Indian will be hungry enough to begin farming in earnest. Except we believe it is necessary if he is ever leaving his barbaric ways and enter civilization. Indeed, it is for this very reason that we have begun giving rifles to the Indians as part of each treaty. For without armaments, they cannot hope to wage war with us, and the process of civilizing them would be hampered in every way. Another aspect of our benevolent attitude towards these savages is shown by the government's policy of having its official interpreters translate everything incorrectly when interpreting for the Indians, will thereby anger them and force them to learn English for themselves, which, of course, is the first step in civilizing. Come to mind of a story told me by a munitions manufacturer. Well, it seems by accident he sent a shipment of blank bullets to the Kickapoo Indians in it. Well, I won't tell you. It's too involved. I would just like to say that I'm sick and tired of these so-called humanitarians. Take no account of which the difficulties this government has labored to deal fairly with the Indians, nor the countless lives and atrocities endured at their savage hands. I quote General Sheridan. I do not know how far these so-called humanitarians should be excused on account of their political ignorance. But surely it's the only excuse that can give a shadow of justification for their aiding and abetting such horrid crimes as this. Indians have perpetrated on our people. The excuse that the Indian way allowed the battle to give
Mars.
And what seemed like atrocities to us do not to them, right. Just out of the water.
Free.
But the real truth is the Indian never had the title of soil. We had that title, by right of the scum! And all the Indians were the temporary occupants of this land. They had been vanquished by us. Well, it was in fact our moral obligation. Sir, man, I support the greatest number of witches in Cape. No tribe or people have the right to withhold from the ones above. For example, case of Lone Wolf versus Hitchcock, 1902. The Supreme Court of the United States ruled that the power exists to abrogate provisions of any Indian treaty if the interests of the country demand. Here's another. Case of the Seneca Indians versus the Pennsylvania Power. The courts ruled that the Seneca Treaty was invalid since perpetuity was legally a vague phrase. Vague phrase. Yes. Here's one even better.
Tyler is dying. Sean Grass.
City Hill versus Buffalo Bill is dying.
Supreme Court ruled that the inadvertent slaughter of Buffalo Bill. Sorry, I'm reminded of a reason from the story told me by Jim Custer. You all remember him, don't you? One of the great dumbasses!
handkerchief. Moccasins and beads and feathered headdresses for your children. The sailors give you traps and trinkets. We'll go to help them help themselves. You know, encourage them a bit. We'll raise their spirits. Oh, here we go.
Where the sun now stands, I will fight no more.